Hello, I'm Gavin Hoey, and in this video I'm going to do a deep dive tutorial on how I created this picture for Adorama TV. Now, in the Adorama TV video, I did a short version, a sort of 10-minute overview of some of the best tips and techniques. This video is going to go on longer than that, so if you're in a hurry, go back, watch the Adorama TV version. The link is in the description below. But if you want to find out a few little really inside tips, a few kind of really good tricks, then keep watching, and we'll go through this right the way from the raw files through to the final edit. The picture of Sam, the model here, was taken by Mark Wallace over in Phoenix, Arizona, and the woodland scene in the background was taken by myself here in Sussex. Now, I've got to combine the two together, but the first thing I'm going to do is to get the woodland scene made. So let's close that down. Now, if you saw the Adorama TV video, you know my original plan was to go out and shoot an HDR picture. So let's get this together as an HDR. Here's my little sequence of images. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I'm going to select them all in MiniBridge, right click and choose Photoshop, merge to HDR Pro. Now, in theory, I actually probably could get away with just one RAW file, but it's better to overshoot than undershoot. And I've got everything here that I need, so let's put it together as an HDR. We're going to work on the final picture so it'll end up looking less HDR than it will about halfway through this tutorial, but stick with me. So that'll take a moment or two to gather together because there's a lot of data to process there. And usually what would happen is I would go into 16-bit and start playing with all these sliders and settings. But I'll be honest, I haven't done that for some time, because now when I want to make an HDR, a photographically real HDR, I switch to 32-bit. Now 32-bit only has really two controls. The ability to move this histogram, and it doesn't matter where you put it, it really doesn't matter because we're going to change it all later. And this button here that says remove ghosts. Now this is really useful. You can see the ghosting up here in the top left corner. There's this weird color and artifacting. When I turn on remove ghosts, wait a second, and okay, it's not gone, but it's certainly better. Fortunately, you can choose which one of the images you would like Photoshop to take as the main image, if you like. So that's the one on the far left. Let's go for the second in from the left. That's better. The middle one, yeah, that's even better still. Fourth one along, no, we've definitely got some artifacting. And the last one, yeah, that's not very good either. So I'm going to click on the middle one. And if you look closely along the bottom, you'll see that has a green rectangle round the outside of the picture. That tells me that's the one where the remove ghosting data is coming from. Not that it matters, because we're done here. So I'm just going to click on OK. And that will exit out of Merge to HDR Pro and back into Photoshop. But it'll bring in a 32-bit file. Okay, so what's a 32-bit file? JPEG, that's an 8-bit file. A RAW file, that's either a 12 or even a 14-bit file. This is a 32-bit file. More bits of data, more information that you can play with in your final photo. Trouble is, Photoshop really can't make the most of that 32 bits of data. But I know a program that can. We can check it's 32-bit. Up the top here, you see it says 32, and next to it is a small star, an asterisk. That's telling us that this is an unsaved image. So let's go and save it. Now, if I was to choose save now, it would try and save it as a Photoshop PSD file, but I'm going to save it as, and I'm going to change the format to TIFF. And the reason I like to use TIFF is because it is true 32 bits, and it has no image compression, and I know a piece of software that can open that 32-bit file. Now, I saved it back into the same directory as the original set of images, so we can see it popped up at the bottom. I won't save that. I don't want it as a PSD, because here's my TIFF file. Right-click on it, choose Open With, Camera Raw. Yeah, you knew we couldn't go too far as Camera Raw. All of the original files were RAW files, of course, but I didn't bring them into Camera Raw because I wanted to combine them together and bring that combined file, that 32-bit TIFF file, into Adobe Camera Raw. Now, it's worth noting, to be able to do this, you need to have Photoshop CS6 or later. You need to have Lightroom 4 or later, or even Elements 11 or later. So those software can open a 32-bit file. Other bits of software, older versions of Photoshop, for example, can't. Okay, so here, well, I'm not going to do too much because it's fairly close to what I want, but just to show you how much extra data I've got, normally the exposure goes from plus and minus 5. The 32-bit file, it goes to plus and minus 10, 20 stops. So if I wanted to, I could really work this image to bring back the blues from the highlights. I could work this image to bring back every little bit of shadow data. So if I really wanted to, I could spend time making this pretty amazing. But all I'm going to do here is just bring back the highlights, open up the shadows, and I'm going to paint a bit of light down in here as well. So let's just get the adjustment brush. We'll increase the exposure by a stop and a half, maybe. Increase the brush size. I'm just going to paint a little pool of light just in there. And we can do that because we've got that massive range of data. So we're not losing any information because we have 20 stops of light to play with. We'll put a bit of clarity into that area and a bit of contrast. And I think what we'll do is we'll go back to the basic panel and I'll put a little bit of clarity and contrast. So I'm just tweaking the image as I see fit. I'm going to jump back over to the effects and put a little bit of post-crop vignetting because I want that pool of light to really feel like it is a little puddle of light just coming through the trees, even though that wasn't there at all. I think we could do with a bit of a crop here, so let's get the crop tool and we'll just crop this. I really want something that has that kind of widescreen, almost theatrical widescreen feel. So I reckon that's going to be my image there. Color-wise, it's probably about right, but I think it would suit a warmer color scene a little bit better. So, once more back to the basic, and we'll go and get the temperature slider, and we'll just warm up the temperature there like that. That looks pretty good. So I've been able to make some quite big changes to this, but because it was a 32-bit file, I haven't lost any data. Having said that, I'm going to make some more changes in Photoshop. So we're sticking as a 16-bit image as we come out of RAW. We'll click on Open Image, and now I'm going to work on it a bit more. As I say, I probably could have got away without doing the HDR process, but it was there, so let's make the most of it. Right, so next thing I'm going to do is to make a copy of that layer. We'll just drag it down to the new layer icon, let go, and I get an exact copy. Now I'm going to blur it with filter blur and Gaussian blur. So we're going to really put some blur on here. Oh, what the heck, let's go quite high. Let's go about 40 pixels. So that puts, well, quite a bit of blur on, and I wanted to blur it just to give a nice kind of glow to the scene. And I get a glow by taking the blurry layer and changing the layer blending mode from normal. Well, I could choose something like soft light, that looks okay, but I find screen gives a nice glow as well as a softness. It's a little bit too bright, so we'll just knock the exposure back. Around about 65 looks okay for now, but I may change my mind as I add more elements in, so I'm going to leave the layers separated. Okay, so we're all looking fine here. I'm happy with that. One of the things I like to do when I'm making a composite image where I'm going to add a person into this background is I'll put some rays of light coming through. They just help to separate the background and the person, and it's very simple to do. I'm going to make a new layer, and I've got some special paintbrushes loaded up here, which make this really easy. I've got these rays of light paintbrushes. Where did I get those from? I got them from my website. So let's go over to my website a second. Here we go. And if we just scroll up the side, here we go. So the Friday freebie from a few weeks ago for me, Lightray brushes. You can go and download these rays of light brushes, and they're great for making these kind of streaks of light with a paintbrush. So really, really simple. And completely free over on gavtrain.com. Again, I'll put a link down in the description below. So on their own separate layer, making sure I have white as my foreground color because I want white rays of light. I'll go and find one of these. Let's go with the second one in. Yeah, that's good. And I'll go get the brush panel, and I'm just going to twist my brush round. So I don't want it going straight up and down. We'll make it a bit bigger. And we'll just put one click around about there, and that just adds that streak of light in. Look at that, that's so simple. Let's put another one in. Let's go get a different brush. So let's use the next one along, why not? And this one again, I don't want it up and down, so we'll angle that off to the side. And we'll go put a streak of light coming in through there. So I've got this light coming through, and that looks really good. And I think we can probably just drop the opacity for that down just a little bit, about 75%. I'm going to make one more blank layer, and I'll just go get the standard round brush, because those rays of light have to come from somewhere. So we'll just put that on its own layer with one little splodge of light. And I've put it on its own layer so I can individually tweak the opacity for that effect. And probably around about there looks good, 71. So it's slightly different to the other layer. Okay, so all in all, that's looking pretty good. I think I'd like a slightly warmer tone even than I've got there. We did warm it up a little bit in RAW, but here in Photoshop, I'm going to put a photo filter adjustment layer on. Yeah, the warming filter, and that just adds a little bit of warmth. Now I've got those rays of light coming through, I can see that that just adds a little bit of warmth to the scene. Okay, so all in all, that's my background done. So that's part one, if you like. Now part two is to go and get the model, cut her out, put her on the background. So the picture for this was taken by Mark Wallace, excellent photographer. Again, link down in the description to Mark's website and the video that he shot of shooting Sam here in his studio. So there's some tips on how to do that. Now, I'm not really going to do a great deal of adjustment to the picture in RAW. I could maybe just check the white balance. Yeah, it was pretty close. But she's going to go underneath a canopy of green leaves. So in fact, I'm going to get the white balance and tweak it towards the green end of things anyway. So we're going to put a fairly strong green colour cast. I might tweak it again once we get her into the scene itself. Other than that, everything looks pretty good. Maybe a little bit more contrast, because I like a bit of contrast. We'll fill the shadows a little bit more just to balance things up. We can put some clarity in, and clarity helps to try and get her hair edged out rather nicely. But if I put too much clarity in, let's go have a close look and see what would happen. Okay, then her face, her skin, everything starts going a little bit nasty. So a little bit of clarity here, and I'll put it to a nice, easy to remember number, plus 50. And then I'm going to get the adjustment brush, and I'm going to take the clarity, everything else is reset, down to minus 50. So I can paint away what I just did. So we put plus 50 in the general basic settings, and then we're painting in minus 50 on the skin tones. And as long as the flow is set to 100, that's where we're going wrong. I knew something wasn't right there. Then that will give me a neutral clarity on the skin tones. And I can put less clarity on the skin or more. I can tweak it as I see fit. But it won't affect the hair. And there's a nice differentiation between most of the hair, especially on the right and the background. That's good enough for now. So we'll open up the image into Photoshop. Okay, now I don't want to cut the entire Sam out, so I'm going to take a little bit of an educated guess here. Let's get the crop tool and say we're never going to use anything below the waist. So we'll just grab those areas. And that's going to be the bit of the picture that I really want to work on. So now we need to make some selections to the picture. So first thing to do would be maybe the tricky bit first. Let's do the hair. But it's worth having a look. Can you make your life a little bit easier? I mean, there's this little gap coming through here in the background. I don't really want to go to the trouble of selecting that. So all I'm going to do is get the clone stamp tool and just have a quick look for some hair that might fill in there. Yeah, okay, so this bit here, if I hold the Alt key or the Option key on the Mac, click just there, and then I can just paint in that bit with some hair from below, and it looks pretty much the same. There you go, nobody would know, and that's just made my life a whole lot easier. Okay, so selection. I'm going to use the Quick Selection tool, and we'll just run this around her hair. It's called the Quick Selection tool, but I don't want to make a quick selection. I want to make a accurate selection. And this tool is very good at making a fairly fast and fairly accurate tool, but you do need to watch it. Make sure it doesn't do anything too weird. And it's also a good idea to lift your finger off the mouse or your tablet or whatever you're using every now and again. Simply because if you don't and you go wrong, you have to go right back to the beginning. Like there, for example, ouch, that's not so good. So Control Z or Command Z just to undo, and you don't lose everything that you've just done. Because that can be really annoying. Okay, it's going to be a pain. I get the feeling that it is going to not like me, but... Okay, let's see if we can get this with a smaller brush. And we'll just build it up. No, it's not going to work. Now, if that doesn't work, you can switch to another tool. Let's go with something like the Magic Wand tool. And we'll go in, add those areas in using the Magic Wand tool. So remember, you don't have to stick to one tool or another tool. Sometimes the best tools are the old tools. Sometimes the best tools are the hand-drawn ones. So let's get the lasso tool here. And we'll go and add in, holding the shift key, we'll say, yep, that bit please, roughly down through here, yep, that bit please. I just want the edges selected, because now what we're going to do is refine the edges. Make sure all that bit's done. Yeah, okay, we're good. So refine edge, you're going to find up the top here. If you can't see it, you'll find it under select and refine edge from there. Now, refine edge since Photoshop CS5 and Elements 11 has made selecting hair really, really simple. What you could do is just increase the radius and watch what happens to that hairline. Already much better. In fact, if we go in closer, we'll have an even better chance of seeing some of those little hairs and little bits and pieces. Boom, look at that. What's happening is Photoshop is having a look in the radius that we're saying, and we're saying this is the radius, Photoshop, go find the small stuff in there. And as we increase or decrease the radius, we're giving it more room or less room to find the edges. Now you might think it's easy then, just give it maximum room, but when you do that you can see it's also found a lot of shoulder detail, and if I just turn that on, half the shoulders have been erased away, and I'm not sure that's exactly what I want, so we'll turn that off because that's not working. We'll keep the radius fairly small. The way I like to do it is I use a smallish radius, and then what I do is I get the paintbrush here and I just paint over the edges and I paint in my own radius. So I'm saying to Photoshop, go have a look in these areas, just the areas I'm painting in, because this is the hard stuff. This is the hairline. Notice that I'm trying to avoid going over large areas of hair, and I'm working my way around the outside of the hairline. So we're just slowly, slowly going around. It's also worth noting that it will not find every single hair, and it may find some of the background as well. And that's fine. I'll accept that, and I'm not going to worry too much about getting every single hair. If it gets some that you don't want, then just switch to the Erase Refine Edge tool, and you can just say, well, okay, I'll tidy that up a bit. But my best tip is always, always, always turn on Decontaminate Colors. Two reasons. First of all, the end effect is a little bit better. Second reason is it always produces a layer mask when you click OK. So when you've finished, you end up with a layer mask. That means that you can come in and make more adjustments if you need to, but it also cuts, in this case, Sam out from the background. Right, let's get the Move tool, and we can then drag Sam off of that picture onto the tab with our background that we made a few minutes ago and drop her straight in. Now, I think she's a little bit too big, so we'll just free transform her down just a little tiny bit. Yeah, there we go. So she just fits in something like that, I think looks about right. We'll click on the tick. So you can see straight away that this isn't too bad. The rays of light behind, if I just flick those off, they help to separate the subject from the background. And that really works rather well, especially when she's photographed against the light background. That just makes my life a little bit more easy. So I'm kind of happy with that. I think maybe we could tweak the levels a little bit. She looks a little bit dark. So let's put an adjustment layer in there for levels. And we can just tweak that up. Now you'll notice it affects everything. So underneath the levels, there's this little tiny box with a square with an arrow and a line through the arrow. Very confusing. But what it does is it makes a clipping layer. So it only affects the layer directly below. And now I'm just affecting Sam. So we can just tweak this up. Yeah, there we go. So we're kind of getting the contrast to match the background scene. Now, that looks fine, but the light coming in is obviously very strong from behind. And although Mark did a great job of lighting her from behind, I think we need to do a little bit more dodging and burning. So this is where things get a little destructive. So if you're not totally confident with what you're going to do, save a copy right now, or save a snapshot in history, or make a copy layer, or do something to give yourself that get out of jail free card. I'm pretty happy with that, but as I'm zooming in, I'm just noticing this large patch on her forehead. That's going to be just that layer. So I'm just going to very quickly tidy that up a little bit because that looks just a little muddy. Yeah, that's it. There we go, and a bit on the nose. But the shoulders should be brighter. So making sure I'm working on the layer with the model, I'm going to get the dodge and burn tools, and we're going to get the dodge tool, which is going to lighten everything up. I'll make sure it's set to midtones. Exposure I keep maxed out, and I'm just going to lighten up those shadows just so it looks like the sun is really creeping around on her shoulder, and a little bit on the other side as well, because there'll be a little bit of light creeping in there too. A little bit on the hair, just so we have that nice, yeah, that looks pretty good, happy with that. And anything down here? Well, I suppose there'll be a little bit coming through here too. So I'm trying to match the brightness with what we're seeing in the scene. Yeah, a little heavy. Okay, so I'm happy with that. That all looks like that's working very well indeed. Maybe a little more sun coming through there. Now, there would be perhaps a touch more colour from the green coming in. So one thing that you can do is to make a new blank layer. And I'm going to select a green from within the picture, a green from the trees. And then we're going to get a paintbrush. And I'm just going to dab a few bits of green just on the highlight areas. Okay, so that's going to be hair, clothes, that kind of area like that. They're all going to pick up the greens from the image. So that obviously looks terrible. So there's a couple of things you can do. First of all, I'm going to make this layer a clipping layer. That's the one with the green on. And I'm going to do it by holding the Alt key or the Option key. And if you have a look at the layers panel, you'll see there is that little down arrow with a square that we saw before. And that just clips the effect, so it only affects the clipped layers below, so the model Sam. I'm also going to change the blending mode to color. And I'm going to drop the opacity way, way down just so we have a hint of color coming through. That just adds a little bit of green in there. It's subtle, but it just gives that extra lift. Pretty good. I'm kind of happy with that. So I've got two more things I think I want to do. I want to give the whole scene a nice glow. So I'm going to make a new empty layer down to the bottom of the layers palette. Empty layer. Now this involves a three-finger keyboard shortcut. Here we go. Alt, Control, and Shift, or Option, Command, Shift on a Mac. Then click on Layer whilst you're holding those keys down, and then Merge Visible. So still holding those keys down, when I click on Merge Visible, I end up with a merged layer at the top of the stack, leaving the original layers untouched. That one I can actually blur with a bit of Gaussian blur. Let's go for a little less this time. And I'm going to put the blending mode for that layer, soft light. Yeah, that looks pretty good. So this is coming together really nicely. May just want to tweak that down. Finally, I think the last thing I want to do is maybe just tweak the colors a little bit. Before I did that, I was thinking it could do with being a little warmer. So let's try that. Let's go back to the adjustment layers. We'll put a photo filter on there. And yes, I was right. That just adds some lovely summer warmth coming through. So there you go. There is the completed image from raw files right the way through to our final image. I'm Gavin Hoey. Thank you very much for watching.